Folks, welcome back. Today we're honored to interview Dr. Ellie Phillips, author of Kissed Your Dentist Goodbye and creator of Zelly's xylitol products. Thank you so much for joining us today, Dr. Phillips.
Well, thank you for inviting me.
Absolutely.
This is great.
So I have to share with you, your book has it's had an honored place on our bookshelf for I think about 5 years now.
Six years coming right now.
Okay, so we got it pretty close to publishing date then. That's mm-hmm. cool. So the subject we're going to discuss today is how to keep your family free from tooth decay. I think let's start by hearing from you why this subject of tooth decay is such a passion and such an issue for our global culture. In other words, don't we all get cavities, and what's the big deal anyways?
Well, I grew up in England. Everybody had cavities. Everybody had dentures, in fact. I mean, the thing that was really scary and really horrible was to see 15-year-olds with dentures.
Oh.
People, you know, getting married were given dentures as a gift. And I mean, I think even in parts of rural America, that was something that happened back in, I mean, I grew up in the late 40s, early 50s, and that was pretty normal. My father had all his teeth taken out when he was 35, entering the military. That was prevention. And my mother was 45 when she was told, you know, she went to the dentist 3 times a year. It wasn't like she was some strange lady. She was clean, healthy, took care of her teeth, brushed her teeth, went to the dentist, and at 45 years old, obviously now looking back, it was periodontal disease, but I was shocked, and it just so happened I was a dentist in dental student at the time, and I told my mother, don't do it. Don't have all your teeth taken out. Let me help you save them. And I think that was the beginning of, I mean, my passion really has been forever to save people from unnecessary dental treatments. That's what I do. My book is not telling you to never go to the dentist. Don't read the cover and misjudge it. I am a dentist. I think the greatest things in dentistry, I mean, some of the most wonderful restorations, people's lives have been changed, you know, go on and on. But there is another side to dentistry that is very different now and needs to be different if we're going to save people from what was going on when I was a dental student, which was, well, I graduated 46 years ago, so I was a dental student, as I say, it was in the 60s. And my mother was told to have all her teeth out. She didn't. She basically went through what today would be called periodontal treatments, just like you promote to your through your teaching. Mm-hmm. And I was the one doing most of this because it was before the era of hygienists, and we used to go round her teeth and clean them up, and then I taught her how to brush and keep her teeth clean. And I'm so glad I did, because we learned as we went along that losing all your teeth is a risk factor. There are lots of risk factors for different things, and that means things that put you at jeopardy. Doesn't mean you're necessarily going to get the end disease. We know that gum disease puts you at risk for, I'm sure you've already gone through this, heart attacks, rheumatoid arthritis, you know, sure. So on and so on. But one of the things that struck me going along was dementia. Loss of teeth. If you have less than 9 teeth, it puts you at risk for dementia. And the most interesting thing for me was that virtually all the women in my family had dementia very early, died fairly early.
Wow.
And my mother, had she had all her teeth taken out at 45 years old, would she have had dementia and ended up dying young? She is right now in Austin, Texas. She has some dementia. She has more sort of, her vision is difficult. Her hearing is difficult. And she's now 94, going on 95 years old.
Wow.
So she is the oldest living, well, the oldest, she's lived longer than any other woman in my family with, up until recently, and still, if you ask her, the people that she works with her now, she's got a wit and a humor, and she's still got a lot of her mind. She may not have it as well as we would wish, but
wow.
To me, this gives me such enormous hope that even if you are on the verge of losing your teeth, even if you've been told you have periodontal disease, even if you've got a bunch of fillings and cavities, and they were, my mother had amalgam fillings, she had all that stuff. And yet at 95, she is still walking, still relatively healthy. I would say she's a picture of health. My goal is to do better for myself. And that has been one of the goals in my life, was to learn how do I get my teeth to be healthy, and then how do I help other people do the same thing.
Right, right. You mentioned in your book, there's tons of gems in there, actually. Some things about early childhood caries and how that's on the rise at this point.
Absolutely.
And just some, what we would call some really sad statistics.
People have no idea, because they tend to think that cavities is a disease of, perhaps do people think cavities is a disease of poor people, or do people generally think that we have eliminated cavities? I don't know, because there's so much misinformation, and when the information does come out, if it doesn't suit the look of dentistry, and I think this is one of the problems, dentists think they have to look like they're controlling dental disease. And that's pretty much what I think American dentistry does. It does a terrific job of making people look great. You can have a row. I mean, I know people who have a row of crowns. They've got missing teeth. They've got gum disease. They go every 3 months for cleanings. In my view, that mouth is so unhealthy. It's tragic, because that person is at great risk from a medical standpoint, and yet they smile in the mirror and they look great and they don't hurt, because gum disease doesn't usually hurt.
Right.
Their wives and their family think they look great, or their husbands. It's not necessarily one way or the, one gender or the other. And because everything looks good, they're okay with it. And American dentistry spends its time fixing things, when the underlying problem or disease, and it is a disease, it's, I mean, I try to be graphic. I tell people it's a wormy, nasty little bacteria. And if you looked at gum disease bacteria, they are amoebas and spirochetes, and they're all these horrible shapes, and they are like drilling little things, and they're under your gums. You cannot have them there.
Right.
And you cannot just sit there going to the dentist every 3 months thinking that this, basically, scaling and deep cleaning is rototilling. If you had a bunch of weeds or bad things in your garden growing that were looking like that, and you went with your rototiller every 3 months, consider the thought that if you measured how many there were before your rototilling, your treatment, doesn't it make sense that after you finish doing that, you may have less right away because you've killed a lot? But not long thereafter, you might have an increase because you're not dealing with them.
Right.
You're not eliminating them.
Right.
And I think naturopathic medicine has done a much better job of looking at underlying causes, or maybe they didn't even know them, using therapies that sometimes have dealt with underlying causes. And you talk a lot about oil pulling. You know, if you're at a loss for what to do and you have periodontal disease, go for it. I say go for it. If you're going to, if you don't mind doing it, I personally believe sesame oil is, you know, really high grade sesame oil is one of the best. It's the lignans. It's different things in these fruits and oils that, that help us.
Right.
I think that is one way to go. Pomegranate is great fruit to eat because it also has oils and high vitamin C. It's multifactorial, the way that things help us. And I say, if you've got gum disease, do whatever you can to get rid of it. Even if your dentist says you need to go every 3 months, I would not rely on that, because it is really, as I say, it's like bringing in your gardener to get rid of the weeds with some sort of mashing machine and then leaving there.
Unfortunately, the way that we communicate that same premise, that How on earth is going every 3 months going to address an issue where some of these bacteria can double their population in 20 minutes?
Exactly. And the greatest thing about periodontal disease is that pretty much we know the ones we certainly the main ones are anaerobes. Mm-hmm. And you covered this, I think, in one of your other interviews. Anaerobes hate oxygen. We love oxygen. So if you can find a way to oxygenate your mouth, I mean, I like the fact that dentists are starting to use oxygen. I mean, I've been a big fan of that, even though it's been discarded by the profession that there are not enough studies. I mean, just the fact that the anaerobic bacteria hate oxygen, to me, let's give them oxygen. Yeah, let's get them out of there. And I know the mouth rinses that I recommend in my book to a lot of holistic minded people, because they're found in Walgreens and because they have horrible names and plastic bottles and some of them have bad rap. I'm not saying they're great, and I certainly don't want every child in America to be using Listerine. Don't misinterpret me, please. I created this book and I wrote it for the very reason I made the title so aggressive. I wanted to help people, not necessarily your clientele that view this, but the people out there who maybe just a librarian or somebody traveling around who comes across this book one day and goes, oh, kiss your dentist goodbye. I am so sick of spending money. I am so tired of my teeth hurting. I am so tired of the ongoing treatments. Because that's the person I can help.
Right.
And the therapy that I recommend in my book is sort of end treatment therapy. It's not what you desperately need to do if you have pristine teeth and you have everything else in your health life under control. You don't need to do this. But if you're out there or your uncle's there and, you know, he's a cigarette smoker or or your aunt just won't eat right and has gum disease and is going to the dentist as the last resort, that is not the last resort. I believe we can help anyone.
Right.
And I would say anyone with this regimen of mouth rinses that I recommend.
Right.
And, you know, they work. That's the greatest thing. I have testimonials all day long from people who used to have to go all the time, and they don't.
Right.
They are now under control.
And that's awesome.
That's really the best thing.
That's always music to our ears, too. It's like, oh, that's why I'm doing what I'm doing. Yeah.
Well, and then, of course, the little tests they do these days to measure these pathogens. Can I talk about that a little bit? Because
sure.
There are different tests, and I don't say one. The one I'm most familiar with is called oral DNA testing. But there are others, and they're all very good. There's one group in Canada that have good testing. There are periodontists. There are hygienists who actually take samples, put it on a microscope right then and there if they have the technology to do that. Lots of different kinds of ways to do bacterial testing, and I don't say one is better than the other. Oral DNA is kind of like the most familiar to dentists. It's out
right.
there. It's kind of the one that I promote because it's probably for you, you being somebody who lives in maybe Arkansas or wherever. Just need to find somebody. You can probably find a practitioner the easiest by just going online.
Right.
What they do is they take a sample of your saliva and then find how many of these bacteria are in that sample of each kind. And there are these different kinds. We talked about the amoebic ones and the spirochetes and so on. And they put a little line on this graph that they generate from your saliva sample. And it says that's as high as we are okay with. Above that, we have to treat it. Of course, traditional treatment is antibiotics, and then you've got a whole nother sequence of issues. So my suggestion is, if you think or have been told you have gum disease, try to cure it yourself. I don't know if you can cure it with oral pulling. I don't know. I didn't ever have the opportunity to do that with patients, because it's long and it's complicated, and the people I worked with just weren't going to do that. But right. If you want to do that and you don't want to use my system, what we need to do is collect data. We need to know what is working. And if you were tested and found that you had these bad bacteria and you went away and used oil pulling, go back and get another test. And if you can't afford another oral DNA test, get in touch with Will and Susan here, and maybe then they can get in touch with me and we can, you know, somehow complete the link up here and try to help people find out what happened when they really did do this oil pulling regimen. Did it work as well as these other therapies?
Right.
No?
Right.
Because no dentist is going to be able to tell you to go away and do oil pulling. It's not part of our, we're not allowed to. We would be crossed off. You know, it's bad enough. I'm okay because I recommend things that are ADA approved and are sort of very normal. I don't think we're going to get to dentists recommending oil pulling just like that very quickly.
Yeah. It's not a politically correct or an ADA approved procedure.
Yeah, exactly. But anyway, I do know that when people put on this regimen I wrote about in my book, 2 months later, they have found themselves to be completely clear, even when previously so infected that it caused body inflammation for them.
Right.
So that's very cool if you've had a heart attack and you found you've got gum disease, because you are at high risk.
Yeah.
So I got off your topic. You asked me about early childhood caries.
That's okay.
I went right back to gum disease. But.
Yeah, it's all good. So I've heard you mention a saying in dentistry that fillings grow up to be crowns. Mm-hmm. Now, other dentists who have taken the path less traveled like you referred to the cost of a tooth over the lifetime of the person. You know, you also mentioned that 50% of dentistry is repairing existing fillings.
Absolutely.
So that, I know that's why we both do what we do, because that's wrong.
It's totally wrong.
That's totally subpar. I don't know about right or wrong. It's just not solving the issue.
Well, let's say not wrong, but it's medically a problem, because if you're using amalgam, as we were trained with amalgam. I mean, I am old enough. We did it bare hands, no gloves.
Yep.
We mixed the amalgam with, you know, mercury loose like a liquid, squeezed it out over my fingers, dripping down into this little dappen pot. I mean, you know, I was so mad when I later did some research. I mean, it took me about 20 years to write my book, so it was 26 years ago or slightly more that I started to really wake up and see. Well, first of all, I'd already found out a lot about fluoride. Then I started to understand more and more about amalgam. Then I started to understand about, you know, amalgam definitely is bad. How they let us in the 60s and even in the 70s squeeze it in our bare hands like that is when 1930, we know it was the Mad Hatter was the, I think, again, it was one of yours. I knew that all the way along, that it was the story of the Mad Hatter, because in the hatting industry, they had used mercury and it had damaged their brains. So I've been told that 10 amalgam fillings can be detoxified by a healthy body. Now, what's a healthy body? You know, maybe some people are more sensitive than others, so I'm not decrying the people who want to get rid of amalgams. The problem is that when you put in a white filling, white fillings contain BPA. Nobody was being told this when the white fillings were being inserted. When you put a white filling in, when you've drilled out the hole and you've got this sort of basically a box that you've got to refill with white filling material, it has to get glued in. And once the drilling is finished and they've taken out, hopefully under good vacuuming and good conditions, now they're going to put the glue in and then they're going to glue the white material in. And to harden it, it actually is, oh, I'm sorry, I'm going to move my chair here. To harden it, they actually use a curing light. Mm-hmm. And this curing light pulls the molecules towards itself. So as it cures, it creates this vacuum at the bottom of this filling. And so many people have pain after they've had these teeth changed from silver to white, and they don't know why it is. And, you know, the dentist, a lot of them don't understand why it is either, or didn't in the old days. Now, usually they take more care in layering it and they have better materials. But right. I love these biomimetic dentists who mimic nature, and they actually almost weave a material through the filling to ensure that it doesn't shrink up like that and cause pain. Because right. once there's pain, then the nerve gets involved. Next thing you know, so many of these poor people who went in, unfortunate people who went in to have a silver filling changed, how many do you know that ended up with root canals? Then when you've had a root canal, you have to have a crown. Mm-hmm. I mean, it didn't just grow up to be a crown. Once you've done a root canal, you must cover that tooth over, or because it's so porous, right. it's going to absorb things into it. So, you know, here you are trying to do the right thing for your health, and the next thing, you've got this great big porcelain crown and a root canal. Hopefully the root canal was done well. I think you've had a seminar. I think you've done a little thing, a series on root canals, and yeah. I'm with you. Root canals done poorly are horrendous. I think root canals done because you had an accident is not an issue. As long as it's done, what's the word I'm looking for, under sterile conditions, it never got infected, there were no bacteria there in the first place. You know, it was a broken tooth that quickly got treated and root canaled with good techniques. I don't think that, providing they didn't use toxic chemicals in the filling of it. I don't know why they stopped doing silver. I have a root canal, long story, I won't go through it, but basically a student who failed a dental exam who over-drilled into the root of my tooth, wasn't decayed or anything, he just dropped his drill. And the faculty did a root canal back when I was at dental school with silver. They put silver down the canals. And I don't know why they stopped using that, because silver, of course, is so antibacterial. It's a one. I don't worry about my root canal.
Right.
So it's not one size fits all. It's, what are they doing? Was it infected first? Did you got residual infection, or is it all clean, clear, and is it happy down there?
Right.
Is it happy in your mouth? You know, that's really what we're talking about.
Yeah. 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 That's, we have so many different places we could go with that. I think that one of the things we're going to be doing in the future is defining the various procedures out, because it's so easy for us, kind of going way back to your discussion about how mainstream dentistry by and large just wants us to look good, just put on a pretty smile and call it good. It doesn't matter what's going on underneath the surface. Along the same lines, I think we are very prone to say, oh, amalgams are bad, or root canals are bad, or, you know, whatever is good, and just kind of quickly, flippantly judge something, when in actuality, you know, we have a dentist who's a friend over here in the islands, and what he does is a root canal. He actually still does root canals, and he says, but what I do is so different. So unless we're really comparing a detailed definition of the process, how can we compare?
You cannot. And there was recently an article somewhere, I'm not sure where I read it, about everyone with cancer, terminal cancer, had a root canal. And that's scary. That's really scary for somebody. But it's, again, there were so many poor root canals done in the last 50 to 70 years that by people who shouldn't have been doing them. They were not trained to do them properly. They didn't understand that most teeth, molar teeth, had four canals. They thought, you know, we were not trained that there were four canals. We were trained with three canals. And you know, 3D imaging, the technology of today, sonar, so many things that help dentists do a better job. Yeah. I think that we can get beyond our worries if people choose the right dentist to go to. And that's where, yeah, you're so right. I'm 100% not saying one thing is bad or another is good. It's in whose hands.
Right. And where we come in is to present more material. And I think that the more that we all can educate one another and help one another just raise the bar to where we have a more informed public, well, then the industry will give us what we're looking for more.
That's how we met, right?
Yeah.
Because you had written about licking the pacifier,
yeah.
right?
Yeah.
And I think, you know, you educate a lot of people. I wanted to get in touch with you,
yeah.
and I had seen your work before and,
right.
and had thought a few things now and again, but never really got motivated enough to say anything. But I wanted to let you know that there are studies in Scandinavia showing that parents who use antiseptics and are so worried about something like licking the pacifier, those children often end up with allergies and asthma and medical problems that are nasty things for the child to grow up with. So we shouldn't be worried about a little dirt or a little bit of saliva. What we should worry about is what is the quality of that saliva or the quality of that dirt.
Mm-hmm.
If it's healthy dirt, I mean, dirt is healthy. We know that if it's in the right place. But if you just put some toxic chemicals on your garden, you probably don't want to be eating that dirt.
Right.
Put some Roundup over it or
yeah.
something
okay.
like that.
Let's not go there.
But it's the same thing, you know. No, I don't want to go there. But I'm just saying it's the same thing with saliva. If your saliva is full, teeming with bad bacteria because you have cavities, you have gum disease, you need to be worried about sharing that with your family because it is transmissible. You are sharing your cavity bacteria with the next generation. A grandmother can be kissing or sharing her toothbrush. Today, my grandson was over with me. He wanted to use my toothbrush. We actually had one for him, but I wouldn't have minded because I am so convinced that I can share my saliva because it is clear and clean and it is actually good to share so that he will grow up being infected, or as we call, you know, infection with good bacteria is called colonization.
Right. Inoculated.
It's actually the same thing as infection. It's being covered by bacteria, and that's how teeth become initially, when the first tooth comes in, the kind of bacteria that are going to be in that child's mouth are determined by the very, very first tooth. And people just don't understand this. They're like, what? How can that be? It is because tooth bacteria need a hard, non-shedding surface to live on. And the only hard, non-shedding surface in a moist place in our body is in your mouth. It's a tooth. So these bacteria are specific for teeth. The strep mutans that grows on teeth can only multiply on teeth. And so that first tooth is going to be colonized by bacteria from somewhere. And if you're the mother, make sure your mouth and your teeth are healthy, bacterially healthy, before you go kissing your children, your baby. And then once the first tooth is in there, it's real easy because the other teeth it'll infect the other teeth in the row if you leave them alone. And you know, if you're a little concerned, you can modify it. You know, that's why I'm such a passionate person about xylitol, because it is tiny amounts are able to modify, get rid of the bad, sticky, nasty strep mutans sticking on teeth, makes them slippery so they go away. But most importantly, by alkalizing the mouth, it's creating this liquid around these teeth. I liken it to your teeth are like a coral reef, and this liquid is bathing them. And if this liquid is nice and healthy and, you know, with all the right nutrients for that tooth, so the coral reef will grow the right, the coral reef's covered in bacteria and all sorts of
yeah.
things. That's what it feeds and processes and helps develop the charges that pull in minerals. And your teeth are exactly the same. It is not a fight to, I tell people, too many people want to clean their teeth like they're barnacles off the bottom of some sort of ship, you know, and you scrape and you brush and you. That is not the image I want you to have. Look at your teeth in your mouth like this beautiful coral reef, especially little kids' teeth when they smile. Have you seen pretty white baby teeth? I mean, they are just adorable to look at. And think of them as this tiny little mini coral reef that is growing in your child's mouth, and leave them alone. Don't let anybody, if they're healthy, start cleaning off that biofilm.
Yeah.
Go to your pediatric dentist and say, if they want to go clean your child's teeth, why? Why are you going to clean them? I mean, why? I cannot give you a why answer beyond the money it generates, because there isn't a reason that I'm aware of.
Yeah. Yeah.
Is that too complicated, or do I make sense?
That's very direct. I appreciate the honesty there. I don't hear that from too many dentists. Thank you.
Well, so, it's not politically correct, probably, to say. Well, it is, because it's the truth.
Yeah.
And I believe dentistry really does want to promote the truth. I just think they have had a hard time. I did ask this question and was told that most parents want a cleaning, and it takes too long to explain why you don't want to do one. So maybe we can educate the public, and they can go in there with their piece of paper ready to ask, please don't clean my child's teeth if they don't need it.
Right, right. So you're a leading expert and one of the major proponents of the benefits of xylitol, like you've mentioned. Would you take a moment and share with us what you've come to realize why xylitol is so helpful if someone wants to steer free of decay?
For this reason, I believe that you can prevent. I think it is truly preventive. I am not on board with the whole philosophy of fluoride to prevent cavities, which is what, if you really look closely, the verbiage doesn't ever say that. Because fluoride cannot prevent a cavity, except for the fact that it can help put minerals into teeth. And I guess if the teeth are really strong, they will resist the acids formed that are the first stage of a cavity. So in that sense, I guess fluoride, the right kind of fluoride, at the right dilution, spit it out, don't drink it. I think there is an argument to be made that fluoride has some preventive measure by strengthening teeth. Let's put that over there for now, because xylitol is truly preventive, in my opinion, by developing healthy biofilm. And if you have healthy biofilm, it's on the outside of the teeth. You have to really reprogram your mind to stop thinking about cavities like a kind of blister that happens on your finger and, oh my gosh, I have a cavity. A cavity takes a year to form. It actually takes about 6 months to reverse, so you should never have a cavity if you're on a good preventive program. And if you are getting cavities, something's wrong with your program. And the program consists of making sure that bad bacteria don't get the chance to stick on your teeth. It's only if they're sticking on your teeth that they can create the acidity that will basically bore into your teeth, little channels into which the bacteria go, and then that keeps on happening until you've got the kind of mush of bacteria and softened tooth and acids all living now in an anaerobic environment inside the outside layer of your tooth. Mm-hmm. And xylitol, the great thing about xylitol is it can get rid of those nasty, sticky bacteria that caused all that problem, so they don't cause that problem. Once you have this cavity inside the tooth, the other thing is that xylitol really still can do its work. It can get in there because these bacteria still take liquids from the mouth to feed themselves. And they usually create a little, almost like a channel. To dentists, it looks almost like a straw because they can be underneath the surface, and then there's this almost like a breathing tube to the surface of the tooth. And if you come to a dentist and talk to them about, I mean, this is one of the problems of fluoride. Fluoride only works on that really outside little, I liken tooth to an egg, okay? It's much easier to explain. The outside shell is the enamel. The white part of an egg would be the dentin. And the yolk would be the live part in the middle, which is cells and nerves and blood supply and everything. So fluoride really only can work on this really tiny, tiny shell on the outside. And it's very good at doing that because it grows these crystals, because the crystals are not live. They're just like an eggshell, and they can grow and they can mesh together. But if you've got decay underneath, there's this little breathing tube for these cavity bacteria to keep getting liquids from the mouth. So the enamel never completely closes over to completely repair this cavity. So you cannot fix a cavity, in my opinion, without xylitol, if you've already got one. And xylitol will address these deep bacteria. It will address preventing them sticking to the teeth. And most of all, which is the most wonderful thing about xylitol, in my opinion, it grows the healthy ones. And it grows healthy biofilm in some miraculous way that I think we still don't fully understand. It's antifungal, so a lot of early childhood tooth decay is a combination of bacteria and fungus. And so if you are thinking that your child or know your child has a beginning from your nursing, don't give up the nursing. If you think you're going to do that, write to me. Keep nursing your baby, please. Don't be threatened or put in a corner. Dentists should not be telling you to stop nursing. They should be telling you to wipe the baby's mouth with xylitol, because it will keep the bad bacteria from growing. It will promote the good ones that protect the baby's teeth. You then can go on nursing, and everything will be just fine in that baby's mouth. And I'm a mother of five. I'm a grandmother of 6 3/4 babies. And I know my grandchildren are not going to have any issues unless they deviate from the advice grandma gives them. Grandma Zelly does her best, and I can't control my kids or my grandkids. But we have this great belief, and it's a family belief that's grown over the years by just seeing it work. Even if you think you're going down a wrong road, you can come back really quite well using xylitol and the correct mouth care.
So I presume
that's what I love. It.
I'd love to back up for a moment. You talk about the straw, the canal that the decay organism in the cavity have to access the fluids in the mouth. I presume that then xylitol goes into the solution of the mouth.
Yeah.
These bad bugs take up the xylitol solution. It kind of it messes them up. Yeah.
Wow. And it does it simply by, you know, stopping them from multiplying. Right. The problem is they're down there multiplying.
Right.
Now, I like to use an oxygenating mouthwash as well. If somebody's got a cavity into dentin for that same reason, I'm hoping it will go down and get in there. So I recommend, you know, this mouthwash that changes into oxygen. But if you've got a dentist who does ozone therapy, or you've got some ozone oils. I mean, there are different things that can be done. I am certain. I am certainly not going to be dogmatic that my way is the only way. That's not who I am. So, but you've got to understand what I would like to teach, and I think you have the same interest, is the biology.
Right.
And then let's all work on it. And then let's find a way to communicate what we found really works. My system really works on. I don't know if I told you the story of a man who was a sea captain who had 15 cavities right into dentin. His mother's hygienist, his father is a dentist. They took the x-ray to show these 15 what they call interproximal. I mean, classic cavities that a dentist would freak to see. The trouble was, he was leaving to go to sea for a year and a half. He was actually away for 2 years. But his mother, as a last resort, said, take some xylitol, you know, Dr. Ellie's stuff with you, and good luck. You know, we'll see you as soon as you get back. And when he returned at the end of 2 years, they retook his bite wing x-rays. Everything had gone away.
15
interproximal cavities.
Into the dentin, not a superficial cavity.
Into the dentin, the kind that make dentists go crazy.
Right.
And I have asked if they would be kind enough to give me the x-rays before and after. Okay. So I'm hoping to have those. I have done this before. I have done these. I am not surprised. This was not news or anything new to me. I know this works. I know you can do it. but you have to use the complete, something to get rid of those deep bacteria. And oil pulling does not work on cavity bacteria, to my knowledge. It might help these deep ones, I don't know. But to my knowledge, that would be, I've mentioned oil pulling towards periodontal.
Right, that's what the research that I've read is that oil pulling addresses periodontal issues pretty darn well. Mm-hmm. Or, you know, at least early stages.
I think it's almost like suffocation, probably. Yeah. Some sort of, I don't know, maybe pulling them. I don't know how it breaks them up, but yes. So
what are, you know, you mentioned the biology. What are your thoughts on the oral microbiome and the role that plaque plays in the mouth? I mean, you know, our culture likes to say that all plaque is bad. Is this an overly simplistic perspective, in
totally.
Your opinion?
Totally. And I think, I mean, I like to read medical history. I think how it all started out, you know, it was the same in medicine. We thought all bacteria were bad, right? And then we found an antibiotic that worked on it, and everybody was, my mother's, I was probably almost a teenager by the time antibacterial antibiotics came really into use. And I remember as a teenager being on a year of antibiotics, I think it was, or soon thereafter, because this was such a miracle cure. I had bronchitis, you know, and then so throw this antibiotic at you, you know, and they just got out of hand. And you know, when you look at the world today, we're overusing them. My daughter breastfed her baby with great difficulty because she was a working mom for a year. I mean, pumping and making arrangements and travel things where I would go. And, you know, we had all this effort to breastfeed her baby because we so believe that establishing the microbiome cannot be achieved better than with breast milk, if at all possible. And then she went to the well doctor visit. The doctor looked in the baby's ear and saw it a little red and said, I think I'll give you a course of antibiotics for his ear infection, to which she said, no, thank you. Yeah. And, you know, didn't. She treated it with an essential oil, and you know, the child's grown to be a tough little kid now with no ear defects. And hopefully a really healthy microbiome digestively, and I hope orally, because she hasn't let them have cleanings ad infinitum at the dentist. And we've got to ask ourselves, plaque is what? Plaque is an infection. And it's, again, back to these bacteria growing on this hard surface. These bacteria are unique because they are almost like, think of them as spiders. And they are able to stick to the tooth with these like web-type things that they make out of sugars. And they also are able to layer upon layer because they can stick to each other. Mm-hmm. And they become, people don't understand that early in the infection, they're little tiny round cocci or COCCI, little, almost like seeds, I like to call them.
Right.
Essential oils are quite good on those early bacteria because it pops the outer skin. Mm-hmm. But within 12 to 24 hours, these little cocci turn into little wormy things. And it is this wormy shape that stick to your tooth and line up almost in columns. They call them columna. And they're able to get thicker and thicker and thicker. That's unique to this breed. And it's only one kind. It's like dogs, you know, a dog is not a dog, right? You have a little corgi or you have a Great Dane. That's not the same thing. Right. And it's as if one tiny breed of dog were a problem. In the mouth, we're talking about bacteria, okay? So it's one breed of bacteria that is the real issue. It's not all streptococci. It's not every single kind. It's just this one wild strain, and you can get real aggressive ones, and then they stick, and you've got to get rid of them. And they do no good. There's nothing good that comes of them, and it's when you can actually see it or scrape it off your tooth, that is actually a seething mass of multi-layers of these columnar stuck together bacteria. If that's gross, I'm happy, because you will be working to save yourself from that. And the cool thing is that teeth will be covered by something. And if you allow it to be covered by this mesh of proteins with good bacteria woven into it, it's almost like a linen layer, or more like perhaps a saran wrap, except I don't like the idea of plastic. What can we liken it to? It's natural. It's like anything.
It's like an ozone layer. It's a protective layer.
It's a protective layer that covers over your teeth. It protects them from chemical damage when you're eating. I mean, love turmeric things and curries and spicy things, but your teeth don't.
Right.
And you need that layer to protect your teeth from that chemical attack. When you drink something hot or cold, this regulates thermal regulation as well. So your teeth don't.
It protects against acid dissolution too, I imagine, from acidic drinks or foods too.
It's everything. It's truly, we need to protect this incredible layer that mechanical, physical. I mean, when you're eating something crunchy, if you're vegan and you're eating all sorts of lots of crunchy whole grain things, you need that protection. Otherwise, you're going to wear away your teeth.
Yeah.
And so I don't care who you are, we need that protection. And it's by stripping it with bad products. And on that topic, I think it's not one size fits all either. I think there are gender differences. I think there are people with acidic saliva. If your own liquids in your mouth are acidic, mm-hmm. you're going to grow a different kind of biofilm. If you have lots of protein because you're a guy and you got lots of protein in your lymphatics. And I mean, I don't know. Nobody's given me this research. I made you read that big book, right? So you can tell me. Grandma Gazelli hasn't got time to read it anymore. I'm sure there are differences, gender differences in saliva. I am sure we'll find gender differences probably in the profile of what's in this incredible biofilm. And I think what we need to do now is figure out what is a healthy biofilm.
Yeah.
And then we should be testing. And instead of scraping barnacles off the bottom of ship technique cleanings, we should be saying to our healthcare professionals, how's my biofilm?
Right.
You know, let's not try and destroy it and scrape it and scratch it. And let's nurture it and hope that it will then nurture us.
Right, right. Excellent point. So what's your take on oral hygiene? I know you've got some contrarian perspectives here that I want to bring to the table. Do we need to brush twice daily? Do we need to floss daily? What about scrapings? What about root planing? Because we get this question all the time.
Can you ask me one at a time? Because I go down a rabbit hole.
Give me your take on flossing.
Okay. Flossing needs to be understood for what it is. We are talking about developing a healthy biofilm. We're talking about a coral reef and nurturing the liquids in our mouth in order to develop a healthy biofilm. We're talking about using things like xylitol and good diet, nutrition, and so forth, so that we don't grow a mass of seething, sticky bacteria on our teeth. What are you doing with your floss? Are you getting a piece of corn out from between two teeth? I'm okay with that. But if you think you're going to change your oral biofilm structurally or bacterially with a length of string, I don't get it. Hmm. I never did get it. Hmm. I never could understand what it would be about. And then the studies came out that said, back in 2001, they looked at all the methods of protecting teeth from caries, for example. Let's take caries first. And they did brushing, flossing, xylitol, all these things. And they showed how xylitol, when used appropriately, 6.5 grams a day in divided doses, can eliminate 98% of plaque over 6 months. Okay, that's pretty great. They showed that brushing and flossing done well by a hygienist, you're lucky to get 40% of the plaque out of the mouth. There are no studies to show it's much better than that. Hygienists will scream at you that you are the one who's not flossing. What they don't perhaps understand is maybe nobody can floss properly, and just there so happened to be 5% of the population that just has healthy biofilm by coincidence, and the rest of the population is trying to follow the advice it's not working, so it becomes pretty depressing to be yelled at every time to keep flossing.
Right.
And that's where I came again in to say, use my system and you'll get accolades at the dentist. You can sit in the dental chair after you've used the system I recommend and probably find within 2 or 3 months of doing this, the dentist will say, wow, good job flossing. And I recommend you do not tell them that you are not, because they're not ready to hear it yet.
Right.
They'll put a little mark on your chart that will make them hate you every time you come in. And so you're better off to just nod your head. Don't lie. Don't say anything. Just sit there and then go away. Keep on the pathway that is working for you and then see what they say after a year.
Yeah.
If it's working, keep doing it.
Yeah.
And if you have the only time, if you want to floss because it makes you for some reason feel better, you have to have healthy gums to do that. Because if you floss and you have unhealthy gums, again, you won't hear this from the dental profession, but you'll hear it from me because I care about people dying. I do not believe you should floss in an infected environment any more than if you had an infected finger, I would tell you to rub some string over it to try and rub the bacteria off it, because you would have more chance of opening a wound, and into that wound might go aggressive bacteria that could get into your heart, your carotid arteries, I don't know, into your brain.
Sure.
I do not think we should be flossing this aggressively.
Right.
Unless you have a totally healthy biofilm that's been, you know, you have no pocketing, no inflammation, and you're all set.
Right, right. We have very similar stories from customers who come to us after. We love the what we call the after the dental visit testimonial. That and most customers end up saying, yeah, I didn't want to tell the dentist that I wasn't following their directions, but I was just, you know, using your guys' products. And it's fun. It's fun to hear for sure.
I think it's just, you know, as I said, for different people, if you're coming from a place where you don't have a ton of plaque, I think you can floss. I wouldn't worry about it. And if you want to floss, your goal should be to get your mouth completely healthy, no pocketing, no, you know, I don't accept 4 millimeter pockets. Pockets of 4 millimeters shouldn't be there.
Right.
And I believe you can do it even without water picks and even without tongue scraping. If that helps, I haven't got the data to argue. I just know how I've done it, and I know how successful that has been for me and for people who I work with. You also have testimonials, and that's great. We're all on the same team.
Totally.
Helping people not have heart attacks, dementia, stroke, and arthritis. Whether your teeth are pristine, that would be my goal for you. Or if you've already had crowns and bridges and even dentures, you should be doing this so that your mouth is healthy.
Right.
I mean, it's beyond little pearly whites that you bite up and down on. This is a much bigger medical part of your body that is, in my opinion, the center of all health.
Very well put. You know, our background is in the Chinese longevity arts. Susan and I met in a Kung Fu school. We've been studying Tai Chi for 30 years. And in the Chinese medical paradigm, in that Chinese thought, the mouth is the center of the body.
Really?
Which is like, well, how does that really work? But
oh, wow, I didn't know that.
Yeah, from our discussion here, the mouth is, the way that we put it to our Western mind, is the mouth is the headwaters to the whole microbiome, right?
Absolutely. Well, and you know what's really interesting? What is the Chinese book of Qing, with
the I Ching.
In there, and I'll have to share this with you afterwards. I made a photocopy of it. Somebody reported that they had done a tremendous job of defining hard and soft tissue dental issues. They had divided it from tooth decay and gum disease. Mm-hmm. And that they actually recommended something called Zinhitong, which I don't know. Somebody told me that was sugar from the white tree.
Interesting.
Is that possible?
I'll look. Cool. I'll dig into my Chinese herbology book.
I did try to have somebody research it for me, but they were they never got back to me.
I will definitely take a look. So one last question for you, Dr. Ellie. What help our listeners understand the truth around the, I mean, this is just gospel now about, oh, you have to have your teeth cleaned every 6 months.
Why?
So I you've already shared this. When was the last time you had a dental cleaning?
I haven't had a cleaning, and my last cleaning was about 30 years ago.
30 years.
Yeah.
Right.
And some of my children never, I think my youngest never had a cleaning. But now don't misinterpret me. I think you should have an evaluation.
Right.
I evaluate my teeth all day, every day, because I am constantly protecting them.
Right.
I think about them. I eat a meal and I alkalize my mouth. And right. I do it either with alkalizing foods, like something that, there's cheeses, there's celery, there's salty nuts, and of course there's xylitol. A xylitol mint or gum immediately alkalizes your mouth and protects it. So, but, you know, the thing is, I've lost my complete train of thought. What was the question you asked me?
Dental cleaning.
Oh, yeah. So you asked me this question about dental cleaning. I think that it's great to be evaluated by a forensic type dentist who is looking to find things for you that you are then able to go home and correct. I mean, that's the value of, in my opinion, a really good forensic healthcare professional. The trouble is your dentist is probably not the one, because today almost none of them are trained or have a great interest. They leave that to the hygienists. And many of the hygienists are told they're not able to do certain things, or they have a production schedule that they have to keep up with. Right. But what you really want is somebody, and I hope we can get to this point where we can recommend healthcare professionals who are doing this, who will do a really good evaluation of your pocketing around your mouth with something other than a sticky probe that they jab down until you scream. I mean, there really are ways of finding out if you have pockets that are not that uncomfortable. And, you know, there's different new technologies, thermography, all kinds of things that we can talk about another day. So you need to know if you've got periodontal pocketing. If you have, you need to have a bacterial test, in my opinion. And then you need to get on a program and be tested to make sure that that has gone away. You do need to understand that if you're living with somebody who has periodontal pathogens and you're kissing them, we've already covered this, but sometimes people are like, duh, they're going for these cleanings and they didn't realize they're living with somebody who drinks 20-ounce energy drinks and doesn't take care of their teeth, infecting them.
Yeah.
So you got to understand this is a family event, whether it's cavities or gum disease. It's not just you. It's this entire thing. Clean your toothbrush every day or anything else you're going to put in your mouth to try and clean your mouth. I'm all about cleaning, keeping things clean, I should say. Your toothbrush, however, in my humble opinion, and this is where we're going to disagree, is mainly for stimulating circulation in the gingival tissues. And this was something I was taught as a young dentist in Switzerland. And I actually will find you, I think I promised you this and I never sent it to you, the video of toothbrushing from Switzerland. Hmm. It's all in German, won't understand a word of it. But it really is a question of massaging your gums. And I know you teach Bass Technique and you sell a Bass Technique toothbrush, which is a nice little toothbrush. But I personally, and again, this is Ellie Phillips based on what I learned as a young dentist. And when I was in what I do with a patient is I'll sit them in my dental chair. I stand behind them and I give them a mirror so that they're looking at what I'm doing. And I will literally brush their teeth for them to show them where to go. They have to go to the very, very back, and then they work on the gums all the way around. And the easiest place to miss, if you're right-handed, is here. Mm-hmm. If you're left-handed, it's here, because you're going to turn your wrist over. And there's this real awkward spot right under your nose. It's very difficult to get to. So you have to pay attention. You have to move your toothbrush around beyond that midline, and then you finish up. Then you'll do the inside, and you're stimulating the circulation, because in that blood supply and lymphatics, you're going to bring white blood cells to clean up the mess, and you're going to bring nutrients to nurture and regrow and heal the gums.
Yeah. I don't think we disagree on that subject as much as you might have inferred there. So no. I'll have to send you an article that I wrote, that the reasons that we brush, and it's all about massaging and stimulating the gum tissue.
In the old days, yeah, they would use the twigs from the miswak stick. And right. I mean, that makes sense, because again, the miswak, it tastes awful.
It does.
The miswak stick makes sense, because they used to do it 5 times a day. It actually contains a little fluoride, a little silica, and some resins. I mean, it may stain your teeth, so I'm not, again, sure whether that's what everybody wants to do. But they would then clip it off with something a bit like a cigar clipper, so that you start with a brand new, fresh piece.
Right.
Makes so much sense to me.
It does. It does. So one last question for you. Give us your rundown on sealants for children's teeth, because that's another kind of a gospel one these days.
Oh, yes. There's so many things, aren't there? And I never really answered all your questions. So I did tell you that the 6 months cleanings, by the way, was a marketing company that set that up back in the day when we had telephone answering machines. And it's based on no science whatsoever. People used to go once every year. You ask your grandparents how often they went once every year. Couple of years, but it was the telephone marketing people that used to do these campaigning for politicians, and they had this brilliant idea that they could do the same thing for dentists with patients. And of course now it's texting and there's more people doing this stuff.
Right.
It's not based on science, and people have 6 months cleanings regularly unless they have gum disease, when they'll go from 6 months to 4 months to 3 months and so on, because they're just, as I said, rota telling. We're back to the beginning. But the average person, especially somebody with dry mouth, that is too many cleanings, because you are not able quickly to regenerate the biofilm that's been taken off. So if you have a healthy mouth, but it's a dry mouth, be real careful how many cleanings you have. Mm-hmm. And as you get older, more, less, maybe more.
That's right. Right.
So your last question for me, sorry, I kind of interrupted you there, was
sealants in children's teeth. Yeah.
Again, I guess it's not so difficult now, because we've talked about so many other things, but it sounded like a great idea. You block up these deep crevices with a plastic material. I used to tell my own patients, it's kind of like nail polish, and you block up the crevices and then it's smooth and nothing gets stuck in there, so you don't get decay. And then one day I went away and I go, plastic in children's teeth, BPA. I'm not sure we should be doing that in young children's teeth across the board. There may be a reason. There may be some people who need it, special needs kids with already problematic, you could even argue, I suppose, divorced families where the husband's family have horrible teeth or the wife's family. I don't know the scenarios, but let's take somebody watching this with children. Why would you seal up your children's teeth with a plastic material? And I don't care whether it's BPA or so-called no BPA, because it's equally bad, the new stuff, in my opinion, again, my humble opinion. But what you want those crevices for, nature didn't mess up. This is what I think I am here on this planet to tell people, is that the way we grew, the way we were developed, the way we came out head first down the birth canal, we got stuff in our mouth that actually grows the healthy biofilm. Babies born by C-section don't get that.
Right.
So mothers, if you have the opportunity to spread the love to your baby soon after birth, you might want to do that, because when a baby is born by C-section, dentists will tell you at 4 years old, C-section babies generally have worse teeth than babies born head first normally down vaginal births. So it's important the way nature develops us. Breast milk, we are now found. My mother was told formula milk out of a plastic baby bottle was better. I mean, come on, we've learning so many things that we thought, and we look back and go, how could we have believed that?
Right.
And in the same way, nature did not mess up these grooves in our molar teeth are there for a reason. They are not disadvantageous to us. They are for they can help us. They have the ability to protect the bacteria that get in there first. And there is research from the 80s that showed the first bacteria in those grooves dominate, take over, big guys in the mouth. And so what bacteria get in these new molar teeth when they first erupt into the mouth is absolutely critical. So when your child erupts 18 months old, 16 months old, that first molar tooth, you want to be certain their mouth is ready and prepared. It's healthy. It's full of healthy bacteria. Then healthy bacteria will get in that little molar groove, populate it, and it will become like a fountain of good bacteria to protect the mouth. Now, that's real exciting. If you've already lost that and your child is now preschool, 6 months, 2 years of xylitol, somewhere between 6 months and 2 years of xylitol, and I can't tell you how much, how long, but that's what they do in Europe. They've done it for 50 years. They give preschool children xylitol several times during preschool, because then whatever state of mouth they came with, they will change the bacteria around so that when they're in kindergarten and the new back molars, these adult molar teeth erupt at about five-ish years old,
right. They
will become infected beautifully with the bacteria we want them to be infected with. When we seal up the grooves, we cannot see, we number one, take away nature's reservoir of good bacteria. Why would we do that? It's like cutting out your appendix because you don't want that to be full of bacteria just in case you get a digestive issue.
Right.
You know, if it's infected, it's the same principle. If your teeth are all infected and you don't care and you're eating awful food and nobody's taking care of your teeth, it's the next best thing we can do, right? Block them up, hope for the best.
Wow.
But the trouble is, it's not an advantage, it's a disadvantage. And the real disadvantage is that as a dentist, we know, and I think this is something else most people don't understand, cavities happen in a pattern. You will never have all bad front teeth and perfectly good back teeth.
Sure.
Because the first place to disintegrate is a back molar tooth. These grooves are the first places to decay. So if you're going to the dentist and I didn't ever finish my conversation about the 6 month visits, I think there's times in your life when 6 months visits are wonderful. And when your molars are about to erupt or soon or new teeth are erupting, I think you need to be going. I used to see my patients every 3 months. I saw them 4 times a year. At that time when these children were erupting teeth, I want to see them because I want to make sure. Remember I told you a cavity takes a year to form.
Right.
You start to see the damage. Within a month, 2 months, you start to see a change. The enamel becomes chalky. If you've got your big glasses on and you're looking and you're forensic, you go, that enamel doesn't look good. If you've got technology today, there are things that scan and show that your enamel is weakening. There's
right.
something called the canary system I want dentists to start putting in because you can really measure. There's some other similar equipment, but it needs to measure the strength of these teeth. And then the dentist, if it's a good dentist, goes, oh, watch out, this is going the wrong way.
Right.
And as a new tooth comes in, they are so vulnerable, they are soft, they are so easily harmed and get infected. And if you're going in the right direction, they will quickly harden. And then the dentist can just look and say, the grooves look great, everything looks wonderful, you're out of here. Whereas when you've sealed those grooves, what are you going to do now?
Right.
You can't see a thing. You have just put the blinders over your lovely forensic dentist's eyes. So even if they care about you, they can't see a thing.
Right. Right.
And the only way they can tell now is to x-ray you constantly with bite wing x-rays to see if maybe you're developing something between the teeth, because that is the next place that goes bad. Is at that point where the teeth meet together. So there's this sequencing of decay, because it is a bacterial disease across the mouth, and it attacks always the weakest places.
Right.
And if you can't see them, if you can't see the weakest places, you've got to wait until you see evidence in the next weakest place, which is much, much less, much more invasive, much more difficult, because it's these places like tucked under things and between things, and it's easy to not see. So
right.
I am not in favor of sealants for those reasons.
Yeah. I think that whole subject of the pattern of decay is another subject I'd really like to tackle with you in another
sure.
interview too, because I think that's a fascinating one that when you first mentioned that to me, I'm like, wow, it really makes sense. So I further
yeah.
looked into it, and I think you're really onto something there.
Sure.
So let's pull this together. Where can someone learn more from you if they want to continue the conversation with you, Dr. Ellie?
Well, I think to start, probably at this point, to read the book if they can stand it. You know, I know reading is hard. Kiss Your Dentist Goodbye. If you actually enter that on Amazon, you can buy the book. Or if you want to go, I have a website, drellie.com, and I am about to revamp it. So it's very old. I had actually given up almost. I had beaten my head until I met you guys and a few other people. And it's funny how it starts to all happen at the time when you have really taken this load, this burden for as many years and carried it as far as you could carry it. And you're saying, I can't take another step. That was where I was. And then some domestic things were happening and babies were being born in the family. And I'm going, do I really want to keep carrying this burden? And then I met some interested people who were not against me, but they were encouraging. And
right.
I felt we could work together. And I don't want to be alone. I've been alone for 30 plus years on this venture. And I want to be part of a team. I want to work with many patients. And again, I don't say that my way is the only way. I think we need to find out the way. I want questionnaires and surveys. And I think we can do this together. And I think it's going to be really exciting. So I'd say right now, my website's old. Don't get turned off by it. Stay in touch with you is probably what I'd say. Because the minute I got my next book and my new website out,
we'll stream
I'm
it from
sure
the
you will... give me some kudos and people will come and visit when I've got it ready, because it's still really 10, 15 years out of date, because I couldn't get the energy up because there was nobody listening to me, or so few that I felt, you know, I wasn't sure I could keep at it.
Right.
But thank you for energizing me. All my peers are retired and on the beach somewhere in Spain, I think.
Well, by all means, we'll have to get you over here to Hawaii and we can shoot some fun video together when your book
there's
launches.
There's an idea. There's a really good idea.
Dr. Ellie Phillips, thank you so much for your time and sharing all your experience with us. It's really been a pleasure.
Thank you for having me here today.